Now, speaking of AI, tech experts are warning of more hyper-realistic and hyper-personalized scams this year as cyber criminals use the technology to improve their schemes. Andrea Taguines reports.
From love scams to online shopping scams and incessant phishing text messages, you may think we've seen it all. But a cybersecurity expert warns cyber criminals are constantly looking for ways to beat the system and fool people, and artificial intelligence could be one of the tools to achieve their nefarious plans.
Kasi dati pag nanakaw mo yung data o meron silang data, anong gagawin nila dito sa data na to? Dahil sa AI, pwede na silang gumawa ng mga programs o mga solutions na makagawa sila ng hyper-realistic, ang tawag namin hyper-realistic, na mga phishing attempts at mga phishing attacks. Dati, pag wrong grammar yung nagpadala sa'yo ng email, automatic na yan, scam yan. Ngayon, dahil sa AI, ipapasok nila sa ChatGPT na gumawa sila ng letter tungkol sa taong ito, na nandun na yung mga names nyo, nandun na yung data nyo. So, hyper-personalized.
And since many Filipinos are on social media, Samaniego said scammers are also likely to continue using such platforms to hook victims.
Ito yung mga scam sa marketplace, ito yung mga scam na mga job offer na non-existent. So titindi to kasi lalo pa nilang dadagdagan itong mga to.
According to the Cybercrime Investigation and Coordinating Center, as of November 2023, it had already received around 13,000 complaints of various scams being facilitated in one popular social networking site alone. The agency says it has been doing everything it can to track down these cyber criminals, but it believes social media sites should also be made accountable for allowing their platforms to be a vehicle for fraudulent activities. CICC Executive Director Alexander Ramos hopes this will be addressed with the newly passed Internet Transactions Law.
They're supposed to be self-regulating.
Yes.
Our problem is, when dapat na detect na nila yung IP nung person na nag-register. Example, na-identify na scam ito, nawala. Nag-appear bagong name, pero ang IP the same. They can do that. All they have to do is just block that IP.
Yeah.
In other countries, they're being penalized. No? Dito sa Pilipinas, hindi pa sila nagpa-penalize. With our new law on online transactions, I think they can be penalized already.
Meanwhile, the National Bureau of Investigation announced it is partnering with e-wallet app GCash to help speed up investigations of online scams.
So the coordination is really critical.
With the partnership with NBI, we can actually pursue bad actors who try to use GCash in the wrong way. Pag may nakita kaming, pag may report na dumating sa amin, then it allows us to tap NBI. Pag meron namang nag-complain din sa kanila or may operation po ang NBI, it allows them to come to us so that we can help them in the investigation.
Samaniego meanwhile shared ways on how individuals can also protect themselves from scammers and hackers, such as setting up a two-factor authentication when logging into digital accounts, or by making use of a virtual private network or VPN. He also discouraged using public Wi-Fi connections for sensitive transactions. Andrea Taguines, ABS-CBN News.
A landmark event for the digital asset sector, U.S. regulators for the first time approved exchange-traded funds, or ETFs, that invest directly in Bitcoin. The U.S. Securities and Exchange Commission authorized 11 funds from industry heavyweights such as BlackRock, Invesco, and Fidelity to smaller competitors including Valkyrie, which will begin trading on Thursday. Now, the decision comes a day after a false post on the SEC's X account claimed the agency had approved the ETFs. The regulator then admitted the account had been compromised, causing the price of Bitcoin to fluctuate wildly. A market analyst, meanwhile, is bullish the latest decision would be a game changer for the crypto industry.
So I think it's another key step forward in the development of what is still by far the youngest, smallest, and most retail investor dominated of all the asset classes. I think people that already own crypto may decide to sell the way they own it today, whether it's the futures, whether it's the Grayscale Bitcoin Trust, whatever it may be, and switch to the ETF. End result, I think, will be just more people owning crypto than they do today.
Bitcoin held gains of about 1% at $45,500 following the approvals. IT and process training from Lumify Work says its partnerships with the IT and Business Process Association of the Philippines will make workers in the BPO industry ready for the future. Lumify recently signed a deal with IBPAP to upskill the industry's workers, preparing them for an artificial intelligence-driven world.
The demand is huge. It's a humongous task ahead of us, and not just in the IT BPM sector. And you know, we are here to help them future-proof our labor force, encourage more employability, create opportunities. These courses are ranging from cybersecurity, cloud computing, AI, data analytics, process management, things like that. Which certainly aligns with the top skills in demand in the IT BPM sector right now. So that's where the synergy comes in with our shared mission and vision. And that is, you know, around talent development and innovation. And as you know, I think Jack rightfully mentioned that the goal is to generate 1 million jobs by 2028.
With global unemployment seen rising this year, the International Labor Organization in its latest report said joblessness could rise by 2 million, pushing the global unemployment rate from 5.1% in 2023 to 5.2% in 2024. The UN body says this is primarily because of an expected rise in joblessness in advanced economies as they grapple with high interest rates, debt, and an economic slowdown. According to the ILO, these factors are raising labor market imbalances that need to be addressed, including insufficient wages as well as low productivity. Foreign direct investments into the Philippines significantly declined in October 2023. The Banco Central says the $655 million net inflows was lower by nearly 30% from the same period in 2022. Monetary authorities point to higher debt instruments of $504 million for the decrease now in net investments. Equity capital placements also plunged by 54%. Most of the placements were from the U.S., Japan, and Singapore and were channeled into manufacturing, real estate, and the financial and insurance sectors. From January to October, net FDI inflows were lower by 17.5% at $6.5 billion. The BSP says the recent decline mirrors the impact of inflationary pressures and slowing global growth prospects. Philippine trade deficit, meanwhile, widened to $4.7 billion in November. The shortfall in the balance of trade in goods declined 25.3%. This was larger than the $3.7 billion in the same period in 2022. The U.S. was Manila's top export destination alongside Japan, China, and Hong Kong. Senator Sherwin Gatchalian urges the Energy Regulatory Commission to conduct a deeper probe into the power outage on Panay Island. He says the regulator's investigation should be aimed at determining the personnel in the NGCP that need to be held accountable for the incident.
ERC should pursue a deeper investigation on this, including management, including who are the people right there and then during when this happened. We have to remember this happened January 2. So this is pretty much after the new year. So we have to look at all of those details in order to find out what really happened. Who was not only NGCP, who in NGCP should be accountable? Is it the supervisor? Is it the operator? Who calls the shot at that particular time? Is that person well-trained? Is that person well-versed with the grid code? Is that person well-versed with the protocols? That is something that we need to go deeper into.
The senator adds the blackout on the island could have been prevented if only two projects of the NGCP were not delayed.
If the other expansion projects are already online, we could have avoided this scenario. There are two very important projects that should be online last 2020. This is the Mindanao to Visayas interconnection. There's a surplus of about 1,000 plus megawatts in Mindanao that can be transmitted to Visayas. and the expansion of the Cebu Negros Panay, if these two projects were online, then this excess power from different islands can come into to Panay and help stabilize the grid. But that obviously that's not happening because those projects were also delayed.
The NGCP, for its part, said it followed protocols to address the Panay power outage. The leaders of the Philippines and Indonesia discuss energy and defense cooperation, including rising tensions in the South China Sea. Katrina Domingo has more on the bilateral meeting between President Marcos and his Indonesian counterpart, President Joko Widodo.
Indonesian President Joko Widodo's visit in Malacanang sealed the commitment between the Philippines and Indonesia to further bolster their cooperation in the fields of economy, energy, security, and defense.
President Widodo and I had a fruitful and honest discussion on regional events of mutual interest, such as the developments in the South China Sea and ASEAN cooperation and initiatives. The Philippines and Indonesia affirmed our insistence on the universality of UNCLOS, which sets out the legal framework that governs all activities in the oceans and in the seas.
Aside from agreeing to forge more deals on border security and patrol, Widodo also asked for Marcos Jr.'s support in a possible deal to procure anti-submarine warfare aircraft for the Philippine Navy from Indonesia.
I welcome the strengthening of cooperation on border security, including through joint patrols. But there are many things still need to be improved. I also seek Your Excellency's support related to purchase of anti-submarine warfare aircrafts for the Philippine Navy from PT DI Indonesia.
The armed forces of the Philippines earlier bought two anti-submarine helicopters from the United Kingdom. AFP officials earlier said the Philippines plans to get four more units, but did not say which suppliers the government is considering. Meanwhile, the Philippines and Indonesia also signed a cooperation agreement that guarantees the two countries would aid the other should there be critical supply constraints in the energy sector. Indonesia is one of the world's largest producers of coal, needed to generate power in coal-fired power plants. The energy deal also includes opportunities for both countries in the fields of energy transition, renewable energy, and alternative fuels. After their bilateral meeting, Malacanang hosted a state banquet for Widodo and his entourage, where officials cheered the upcoming 75th anniversary of formal diplomatic relations between the Philippines and Indonesia. After visiting Malacanang, Widodo traveled to Laguna to check the operations of an Indonesian-owned coffee factory. The president of Southeast Asia's largest economy says his country is ready to further expand their investments in the Philippines.
In order to enhance trade, we agreed to continue to open market access, and Indonesia seeks the Philippines' support related to special safeguard measures on Indonesian coffee products.
Special safeguard duties is a trade mechanism that a country can impose on imported products that fall below a so-called trigger price. The Philippines decided in March this year that it will continue slapping such duties on imported coffee products if the items are below the trigger price to protect local farmers. Bilateral trade between the two countries was pegged at $9.5 billion in 2021. Indonesia has been importing copper wire and other machine parts from the Philippines, while the Philippines has been sourcing coal, palm oil, paper, and other materials from Indonesia. Widodo is scheduled to return to Indonesia on January 11. Katrina Domingo, ABS-CBN News.